Increased taxes, spending cuts, those are some of the issues Americans will face if the president and Congress fail to reach a deficit-reducing deal. But what impact will this have on Canada's economy? And can this country also go over the fiscal cliff? For more, we're joined by Ian Lee. Ian's a professor at the Sprott School of Business, and he joins us from our Ottawa studio. Good afternoon, Ian.
Good afternoon, Brian.
Good to be speaking with you once again.
My pleasure.
When Ben Bernanke came up with the phrase fiscal cliff, people probably sat around scratching and thinking, what exactly is he talking about? But it's right there, right in front of us, staring us in the face.
Yes.
If the American government cannot reach, a compromise deal on what to do about the fiscal cliff, what will be the immediate impact on the Canadian economy?
Excellent question. The fiscal cliff, just for your viewers, was set in motion in August of 2011 when congressional leaders meeting with President Obama almost came to a deal. They were 85% of the way there. And so when they didn't, they decided to set up this suicide pact, as I call it, of mutual assured destruction, saying that if they hadn't come to a deal by the end of this year of December 2012, all these draconian expenditure cuts and tax increases would kick in. And it was designed to ensure that, in fact, they would come to a deal. Now, the total amount is about $607 billion in the U.S. That's a lot of money. And overnight, it would be withdrawn, or pretty well overnight, it would be withdrawn from the economy. So the impact, the Congressional Budget Office estimates it would push the U.S. economy into recession. They'll go from about 2% growth to about 1.5% minus, negative, in GDP. And that would have an enormous impact on Canada, because we export one-third of the totality of our economy, and 75% of that one-third is exported to the United States. So the United States would start buying a lot less of our stuff. And that means that exporters to the United States, manufacturing industries in Southern Ontario, for example, would probably lay off workers because their sales would drop precipitously. And that would drive up our unemployment overnight. And certainly Finance Minister Flaherty and Governor Carney have suggested that this would push Canada into recession as well.
Ian, those that are responsible for governing this, the American economy, know the impact of what falling off this fiscal cliff would be. And as you said, they've been preparing for this for a while. Now that it's less than 4 or 5 weeks away, I guess almost 6 weeks away to tell the truth, what is the likelihood of them not reaching a compromise and making sure we do not fall over the precipice here?
Well, I think they're going to come to a deal. I really do. I think President Obama is a very intelligent individual. He's self-interested. We all are. So are the Republicans. The metaphor I like to use, because there's been so many metaphors, some people have likened this to Thelma and Louise. Sure. And I said the problem is, with that metaphor, is that President Obama is not Thelma and Speaker Boehner is not Louise. That is to say, neither of them are going to drive that car over the cliff. And I do think that they're going to come to a deal, because people say, oh, well, look at all the rancor and the toxicity in Washington for the past 2 years. And my answer is, yes, there was. And that all came to a crashing halt on November the 6th, on the night of November the 6th, when it became very clear that the American people reelected President Obama. And that cleansed the air. It changed everything. So the climate is very different. Listening to Speaker Boehner yesterday at the microphone, President Obama, the minority leader Nancy Pelosi, and the Senate Majority Leader in the U.S. Senate, it was striking. They're all, I wouldn't say lovey-dovey, but they're certainly a lot more friendly than they were before November the 6th. And I think they're going to come to a deal, because it's in the self-interest of each of the political parties, the Congress and the president.
No question about that, Ian. As we look forward to what's going to happen once they do come to a compromise, because I'm in the same corner as you when it comes to this, the fact that the Americans approach this so, I guess, walked right up to the edge of this cliff and we're looking down to it, does that mean that they are that close to being a less than powerful economy on the world scene?
That's a very good question. Let me just throw some quick metrics at you, very big picture metrics. The United States is still the largest economy on the planet Earth. It's about 16, 17 trillion, which is about 22% of world GDP. So it's still about one fifth of the entire world. The only challenger that's on the horizon, of course, is China. China's growing very rapidly. We all know that. But China has a lot of problems underneath the hood. Banking sector, you know, state-owned enterprises that are not efficient under the thumb of Beijing. And so some forecast that they're going to surpass the United States in 2020. Others say, well, no, they've got so many problems that there's going to be a hard landing. So I think that the United States, for the foreseeable future, is going to be the world's superpower. It is still, to use that wonderful phrase, the beacon of hope to the world. It's still a democracy, and people still look to it. And so I don't think that American leadership is going to disappear anytime soon.
I don't mean to cut you off. I want to get to this last question before we let you go, because this is absolutely fascinating to me. The size of the American economy, does that make it that much more important? Because let's face it, it's not an efficient economy right now. It hasn't functioned as an efficient economy for the last half decade, if not longer. But is it just the size of the economy itself which makes it the primary economy in the world?
No. The problem, if I can disagree with you a little tiny bit, the problem in the last 5 years, half a decade or so, as you correctly noted, wasn't the U.S. economy. The problem was Washington, D.C. and the U.S. government, and more precisely, the U.S. Congress and its relationship with the president. And so the problem, the United States economy is still the most dynamic economy in the world. People come from around the world to go to Silicon Valley. Google was founded by a Russian. I mean, there's a lot of people there from Europe and India and China and around the world that come to America because it still is the engine of growth, because it's established, it's structured to create economic growth. The problem has been strangled is by policies, bad policies coming out of Washington, D.C., from the U.S. politicians of both political parties. It's not the American people that's the problem. It's the American political parties in Washington, D.C.
Ian, I always appreciate this little bit of clarity you bring to these matters for us. It's always good to talk to you.
My pleasure. Thank you.
You bet. Take care. That's Ian Lee, the professor at the Sprott School of Business at Carleton University, and he joined us from our Ottawa studios.